make sure that you do that set. The next thing I need to talk to you about is those really fun bring bags that all of you have, your toolkits. So I'm going to walk you through a little bit what is in your toolkits tonight and how you can use them. Our goal with giving you these bags is that it will help you set your table. So it's supposed to give you everything you need to have your conversation and set your table. Now I do want to tell all of you, unfortunately, there are a couple items up here, specifically the cups and the pins that did not make it into your toolkits today. We will have those at the foundation's office beginning tomorrow. So if you want to have those, you don't have to, but if you want to, please stop by our office and we will gladly add that to your toolkit. We greatly apologize if that was not able to happen tonight. But so this is where part of the interaction comes in. I want all of you to open up your toolkit bags. And I want you to pull out your host instruction sheet. You can find that. So this sheet will give you all the instructions for what you need to do when you host your conversation. The most important step on here that I want you guys to realize is step number one. And what step number one is asking you to do is to submit your guest information to us. So this can be done either before your conversation or after. But what you'll do is you'll go to the website listed on that step, and you'll enter in your guest's names and email address. That's all we need. We aren't going to spam your guests. We aren't going to send them lots of emails. The reason why we want this information is so that we can send them the survey link and a reminder to take the survey afterwards, and also let them know when our community report comes out so they can be invited to know what the results are. If you have somebody who's uncomfortable with sharing their email address, that's okay. You don't have to share it with us, but what we do ask is there will be a blank for you to put how many participants and guests you had. Please at least at a minimum do that so that we can have a count of how many people participated in these conversations. So that's your guest information sheet. The next thing I want you to find is your host toolkit. So hold it up when you find it. Very good. Okay. This you can also find online if you happen to lose yours. But what this is a guide for how you can plan your conversation. So it will take you through everything from who do you invite to what do you talk about, what are the conversation prompts, to how do you get people to take the survey at the end of the night. So this is your guide to planning your conversation. Take some time to look through it, and hopefully we'll have lots of useful information. The next thing I want you to find is your conversation prompts. You can find those. So what these are, this is a handy sheet you can keep out on the table as you're asking and facilitating your conversation, and it has some sample questions that you can ask. Now Lisa is going to talk a little bit more about how you can guide your conversations, but this is a reference guide, or if you want to pass it around your table so that people can maybe select a question that they want to answer, that's another way that you can use this. Then two more items. The other one, you should have a stack of little notebooks in there. So these are intended to give to your guests. There's 12 of them, so if you need more, let us know and we can give you more. But it has a variety of pages that your guests can take notes on and doodle on. We don't need to receive any of this information. It's private and for them. It's just for them to take notes while you're having a conversation. The one page I want to draw your attention to is the last page. And this page is specifically intended to help you think about what action you can take in your conversation. So it has a question on here about what are two actionable ideas that you want to act on after your conversation. So this is a really great tool that you can use to close and end your conversation. Have your guests flip to the end of this and have them write down two ideas that they're going to walk away with and act on afterwards. And then the final thing I want you to look at is these little tiny survey reminder cards. They're with your coasters. This is where you'll find them. What these are also for your guests to take home, and it is a reminder for them to take the survey. It has a text code. What we really would suggest that you do with the survey is at the end of your conversation, allow 10-15 minutes at the end, ask all of your guests to take out their phone, give them this card, text that information, and have them take the survey before they even leave your conversation. That way you know it's been done. But if they don't want to do that, they'll have this card to take with them so that they remember to take it. So I've given you a lot of information. Oh, there are also additional resources behind Clicker. Online, if you go to onthetable.org to our resources page, you'll find these additional toolkits. One is a youth conversation guide, so if you have any students or youth that are involved in your conversation, which we absolutely love and encourage, there's a lesson plan in there for schools. There's some questions that might be a little bit simpler for youth and kids versus some of our other ones. So definitely, if you're youth involved, please utilize that toolkit. We also have a family discussion guide, so if you're a family and you want to have a conversation with multiple generations, we have a guide for that. And then finally, we have our toolkit has been translated into Spanish as well. So if you have any Spanish-speaking people participating in your conversation, or if you might be interested in hosting a table, please direct me to that resource. Our survey will also be translated into Spanish, so that's another option for you to consider. So, I've given you a lot of nitty-gritty details. And there are three things I want you to remember from what I talked about. And this is where it gets a little more interactive. I see some deer headlight looks. We got that. So, the first thing I want you to remember is to register to host. So, on the count of three, I want you to say register. Okay? One, two, three.
Register.
Very good. The second thing I want you to remember is to submit your guest information. So on the count of three, I want you to say info. One, two, three.
Info.
Okay. And the last thing I want you to remember is to have your guest to take the survey. So on the count of three, we're going to say survey. One, two, three.
Survey.
Okay. And we're going to put them all together. Try this. So on the count of three, say register, info, survey. Think you can do it? Okay. One, two, three.
Register, info, survey.
Great job! Yes. I'm going to join back up to have our real treat for today. All right. Foundation in 2009, she and I both joined community foundations when we had lost a lot of our assets. So it's probably better to come in when you're low versus high and then see it go down. But since 2009, LISAT has led her organization to increasing their assets by over 400%. She had practiced law prior to joining the Community Foundation, and prior to joining the Community Foundation, she and her husband had also welcomed a daughter into their lives. So Lisa ran Community Foundations, which she still does, and is raising a wonderful daughter who's 17 years old and looking towards what college to go to next year. One of the things that Lexington and Columbia have in common is that we are both very community-focused, and we are both looking at how we engage people in the community. So you've all heard of Midland Skids. Lexington, Kentucky also has a good giving challenge that takes place the month of December. And since 2011, Bluegrass Community Foundation has raised over $8.4 million on behalf of 150 local nonprofits. The Community Foundation of Lexington is also very engaged in building community and making sure that the community that they are building is livable, that it's walkable, bikeable, it's welcoming. And underneath is Lindenham. That would be the other community foundation that's not here. Under Lisa's leadership, the Community Foundation has forged an extremely meaningful partnership with the government of Lexington, the city of Lexington. And in fact, their on the table oftentimes helps inform the city plans. Most importantly, Lisa has been a role model for me and a number of women in our field because she's compassionate, she's extremely bright, and she truly cares about the place that she calls home. I am so honored that she is willing to share her time and expertise with us so that we can have a successful on the table. Lisa, thank you. it's just a wonderful opportunity to come together, and I know that you're all going to love it. So, show of hands, how many of you love to talk? You enjoy talking? Okay, I'm worried about a few of you over on this side, but I'll give you another chance to redeem yourselves. How many of you love to eat? Okay, well, if you love to talk and you love to eat, you are fully qualified to host on the table. So I can sit down and you can go home. But that is what we say, and I promise you it's true. If you love those two things, you really do have the fundamental skill set to host a successful on the table conversation. Oh, that's me. So here's the thing, and this is not going to surprise anyone, I don't think, but humans were meant to be in relationship with one another. We just are. And we are meant to engage in relationships and have social interactions. In fact, one of the best determinants of social health, and in fact our lifespan, really is all about the strength of our social relationships and our social networks. So very great change starts from very small conversations held among people who care. I would love to take credit for that, but it is actually a quote from Margaret Wheatley. Margaret Wheatley, she writes and she speaks extensively on the power of conversation. Actually, since 1966, Margaret has worked as an author, a speaker, a teacher, a community worker, a Peace Corps volunteer, a consultant, an advisor, and a formal leader. And from all of these experiences that Margaret has had, she has developed this unshakable conviction that we need leaders who put service over self and who display an unshakable faith that people can be generous, creative, and kind. And on the table is the perfect opportunity to engage with one another in a way that is generous, creative, and kind. So everybody has a story. And I mean, that's what's so great about coming around a table with people we know, as well as people who are meeting for the very first time. And that's the beauty of on the table. It can be people that you already know. You can also mix it up with people that you don't know and that you're meeting for the first time. There's really no wrong way to do on the table. And what you're going to find is that simple questions not only prompt important insights, they really can be critical to bridging differences. Everybody has a story, and by learning someone's story and sharing yours in return, it really is a great first step to building a new relationship. Prompts to get at what someone's story is could include something as simple as asking, what's important to you? How do you want to be remembered? Tell me about your mom and dad. Or why are you in Columbia? How did you get here? In asking that kind of question in Lexington, at the same table, there was someone who said they're eighth generation in Lexington, Kentucky, and someone who moved there 6 months ago to take a job. So those are great sort of rapid icebreaker questions just to get things started. And of course, while everybody has a story, anybody can learn from yours. And the key here is a willingness to share. That's all you need. What you say doesn't need to be profound. It just has to be true. So while cave paintings may date back as far as 35,000 years ago, they now say, from our earliest times on Earth, humans dating back more than 250,000 years, we've had a hunger to communicate, whether that was, again, through paintings or through symbols or through verbal communication, but we've had this need for a very long time. And I will saying it again. Now more than ever, we have such a need for civil and civic discourse, and on the table is the perfect opportunity to do that, to engage it, to role model it. So in North America, again, we have such a tradition, going back to indigenous peoples, of passing traditions from one generation to the next through an oral tradition. It's important to cultures across the globe, just as it is with Native Americans and other indigenous peoples, and who use storytelling, as we still do today, as a way to convey and preserve culture. Gathering together and telling our stories, it comes naturally to us, even though today many of us lack the opportunities to engage this way. But I promise you, it comes naturally to us. I wrote right down those cowboys around the campfire. So, okay, you may not be doing your on the table around the campfire, although maybe you have a fire pit in your backyard, and you will, and that is good too. But I think the thing about this is the fire is so evocative of storytelling. I don't know how many of us immediately think of telling ghost stories around a campfire over the summer, or maybe holiday memories in front of a fireplace, but there is just something really fundamental about gathering together. It doesn't mean you have to sing at your own table, but you could do that too. But sharing a story, getting cozy and intimate. There's something about, you know, that number of 6 to 12 people and gathering around in a circle, although you can use a square table too if you want. But there is just something fundamentally powerful about storytelling and conversation. And really, if you have the courage to have courageous conversations, you can sometimes even change the world. And then, while there are formal, courageous conversations, there's also the informal. There is nothing like getting together with the familiar. You don't have to focus in your on-the-table conversation on solving world peace. I mean, you can take it on if you want to. But, you know, this photo, I think, so perfectly displays why we encourage folks to actually do their on-the-table over food and beverage. And, you know, it doesn't have to be fancy. It can be breakfast, it can be lunch, it can be dinner, it can be tea time, it can be cookies and punch, it can be a brown bag. It can happen any conceivable way. It does not need to cost a lot of money. A potluck like this is a great way to do it. But good friends, good food, and good conversation are naturally reinforcing. And really, it's the small, everyday conversations that matter too, as much as the ones that are boldly courageous. And both can be part of On the Table. You know, conversations can change the country, and conversations can be challenging. But there is a real place for consensus, for collaboration, and for compromise, particularly in our diverse, pluralistic society. We can't move our communities forward unless we are brave enough to engage in meaningful civic conversations. So again, Margaret Wheatley, be brave enough to start a conversation that matters. I think it's excellent advice. And the point is, don't be afraid of the topics that might be surfaced at your table, because it will be a broad array of topics, and that's okay. It could be funny and familial one moment, and it could get serious and intense the next. And that's okay. On the table, there's room for all of it. So as you approach the conversation, I think there's just a few words that I'd ask you to think about. intention. So how do we start a conversation that matters? And I suggest it's with a three-pronged approach and a three-pronged intention. One is the willingness to share. Two is the willingness to learn. And three, you combine that with an attitude of civility. And if we go in with that intention of being civil, it isn't going to matter what the topics are or how intense it gets if we really focus on that intention of civility. Next is voice, really the importance of voice. And what's so essential here is that everyone's voice matters. And especially the quietest voices and the voices that are not usually heard. So just keep that in mind, that every voice matters. And we'll even talk about a few strategies about how to elicit those quieter voices. So sharing is critical. Be willing to share your story and allow others the time to share theirs. I suggest you put aside preconceived notions of how the conversation ought to go and simply be open to the flow of conversation. What I can promise you is that no two on-the-table conversations will be alike, even if it was the same group of people discussing the same prompt, and certainly not if you're looking at hundreds of tables across the two counties. So just put it aside and go with the flow and be willing to share. Truth is also critical. Honesty is the basis of a truly meaningful conversation, and truth is also critical for meaningful change. Listen. This is perhaps the most fundamental part of On the Table, is to listen, to be present, to allow others space, particularly if perhaps some of those others are not so often invited to the table. And again, that's the beauty of On the Table. Everyone's invited. Everyone's welcome. There is no qualification to join the table other than the interest to do so. For most of us in this room, I'll bet it's easy to talk and much more difficult to listen. I know it is for me. It's said that the greatest actors are determined not by the way they say their lines, but by the way they engage and react when listening. They actually say that probably no one's better than that than Claire Danes. So, I don't know, maybe you want to go home and pull up something on demand and check her out when she's listening to other actors. And I guess maybe that's the key to getting both an Emmy, a Tony, and an Oscar. So, practice active listening. Learn. To get at the core value offered by On the Table, we need to put aside the rampant tribalism of contemporary politics. That'll be fun, right? We can do that. If we're confident that we already know the answer to every question, then On the Table is an empty exercise. But if we approach On the Table open to the possibility that we have something to learn from everyone we meet and from everyone at the table, and that perhaps we can learn the most of all from those that are most different from ourselves, then On the Table will prove to be an invaluable tool to glean new insights and information to move our communities forward. Growth. With learning comes growth. And that saying in business that you're either growing or you're dying, it can equally apply to interpersonal relationships and communities. New opportunities like On the Table often present the most exciting opportunities for growth if we just stay open to the possibilities. Engage. Civic engagement is fundamental to a thriving democracy and a thriving community, which is just the main democracy, right? On the table is a simple, open-ended, and welcoming, friendly way to engage with a diverse array of citizens. So really, take the opportunity, and it can be really exciting for everyone that participates. Act. By acting with intention and actively engaging with others to discuss our hopes for our community, the greatest needs of our community, and what we can do together to create positive change, an agenda for action will reveal itself through your on-the-table conversations. I promise. There's nothing extraordinary you'll need to do, but just other than have the conversation itself. Results, we're all very results-oriented folks. And what I can tell you as a product of 2 years of on-the-table conversations in Lexington, Kentucky, and surrounding counties, is that we've learned that the power of conversation to clarify, energize, and organize people to do things for good is real. It really happens. When we come together, as Joanne said, to listen and learn from each other, it can have an incredibly powerful impact. In 2017, which was our first on the table, our unified city-county government was updating its comprehensive plan, which is required to do statutorily every 5 years. In any given 5-year period, they had 350 people that would show up with a standard form of community input, where you show up at a community center or a library and give your input. But as a result of On the Table, they had thousands of people that came to the table to talk about what's great, what could be better, and what we could do to change our community. And one of the most contentious issues in Lexington, Kentucky, is our urban service boundary. We have this 50-mile radius urban service boundary, really, I believe, the first one in the country to actually protect that beautiful rolling bluegrass geography. As you might imagine, it creates a lot of tension with development interests. And at the same time, there are people who point out that both our agricultural industry and our thoroughbred equine industry is a really important part of all of that. In any event, what I will tell you in our most recently updated comprehensive plan, that urban service boundary held. And on the table, and the conversations, and the overwhelming support that was articulated for holding that urban service boundary, on the table has been credited time and time again for giving the people the opportunity to speak and to impact that process. But on the other hand, results from On the Table were as simple as a new community garden being created, or a particular neighborhood association now jointly deciding they were going to actually use those recycling bins that had been distributed because one member was made crazy, one neighbor was made crazy that on recycling day, it was only her blue bin, and everybody else's blue bins were not full to the curb. And she came up with this really fun neighborhood competition and game where everyone could win prizes by, you know, rallying around and getting their blue bins out. That was a result of On the Table, too. In 2018, our second On the Table, 91% of participants reported that they were going to take a specific action based on something they learned or discussed during their on-the-table conversation. There was no magic to that. As I said, the conversations really will lead to the creation of your own action agenda. So I understand there have been a lot of questions about how you do this, and we're moving right into that now. So a question was asked, how do you set expectations for the agenda and begin the conversation? And I think Therese had a wonderful display of exactly what you do. My additional suggestions would be set expectations by being clear in your invitation to your guests. Help them understand what they're being invited to. Explain that you're hosting an informal conversation about not only what makes our community great, but what can make it better. Let them know the time limit, so if your function is going to be 60 minutes or 90 minutes, I'd be really clear about that up front. And remember, you're supposed to reserve 15 minutes to do your survey right there. And then the only agenda I would suggest is that there is no agenda. Keep it informal. Again, if you like to eat and you like to talk, you can do this. And, you know, if you have concerns, you know who you're inviting. And by that I mean, you know who you know, and you know who's going to be a surprise. So you know what the combination of your guests perhaps is going to look like. You know, you might start by reviewing those three quick rules that were laid out in the host instruction card under the don'ts. They're also, by the way, on page 6 of your host toolkit. And you might do something like this right as you're going to start your conversation. When everyone's gone around and said their name and introduced themselves, you might just say, can we all agree on three things as we launch into our conversation? One, we agree not to be judgmental or dismissive of the comments of others. Two, we agree we're not here to argue or promote unproductive debate. And three, we agree to make no campaign speeches or promote particular political agendas. You do not have to memorize that. That is right on page 6 of your toolkit. Now, for some of you, that may not be necessary, but for some of your conversations, maybe that will get you off to a good start. Or if something flares up, you refer to the rules and bring everyone's attention right back there. So that's a little difference about how you begin the conversation. Again, those are the great prompts. I found one of your prompts on page 7 of your host toolkit or on your reminder card that you set on the table. What would you say if you were bragging about Columbia? I would tell you, my first on the table conversation, I probably participated in more than 20 over 2 years. CEOs get around during on the table day. But once we asked, what would you say if you're bragging about Lexington? One thing, we kind of did this quick opening round, and the conversation just took off. We never really had the occasion to refer back to any of those other conversation starters because the conversation was simply organic from there, and I think you'll find that true as well. So, what topics do we talk about? Use your host toolkit. You do not have to worry about this. There are wonderful prompts on the sheet in your toolkit on page 7. And you cannot go wrong if you use any one of those starters. My suspicion is whichever one you pick, you'll very likely never get to a second or a third because the conversation will become organic from that point. And I will say, I did observe one on the table back in Lexington. I'm not going to tell you it's wrong, but because apparently that group liked it, but it was a super host, so there were a lot of tables going on in a single location, and they actually decided to have a moderator up at the front, just like me. All the tables were out there, and they decided to go through all the prompts in an hour and 15 minutes. And I popped in there. And I would, this is just one woman's view, but a prompt would start, and then you would just hear the conversation. You know, the room would get loud, people are discussing, and then it would go, time's up. And they'd have to move on to the next one. And I'm going to tell you that is not how I would suggest doing your on-the-table conversation, unless you want to have like a 7-hour on-the-table conversation, and then have that, do them all. But I really believe part of the impact and the effectiveness is keeping it informal and organic. So what is off the table? What's, again, interesting to me from the Chicago Community Trust, the community foundation there in Chicago that innovated it, the whole name on the table came from their discussion about, if we're going to have a community conversation, what should the topic be? And as they talked about narrowing it down to one topic, someone said, everything should be on the table. Nothing should be off the table. And that is how he came up with the name On the Table. So I suggest that everything's on the table and there's nothing that you need to ban from your conversation. You know, I don't know if in your communities the opioid epidemic or race relations or homelessness or housing affordability or policing or the treatment and status of immigrants or inequities in code enforcement are ever issues, but they are in Lexington and the counties that we serve at Bluegrass Community Foundation. And I will tell you that all of these topics surface at On the Table, along with hundreds and hundreds of others. I think maybe like 800 different topics in all surface. And you know, a few of those that I mentioned that certainly probably have some controversy and strong opinions, a few of those rose to the top as the most frequently discussed issues. And what I'll tell you about that is that everybody lived and nobody was shocked. Those issues came up. So I would encourage you not to take a particular topic and move it off the table. So, how do you manage personalities? And I probably should say, how do you manage difficult personalities and make sure everyone's voices are heard? Again, I might start by getting agreement on those, you know, three agreements before we launch. And then, it probably depends. If the conversation's being dominated by one or more individuals, you might say something like this. Jack, that is great, but you know, let's hear from two more people and then we're going to move on to the next topic. We want to hear from those who've not yet had a chance to share their ideas. Or you could say, you know, Debbie, we haven't heard from you, but I'd love to know your opinion on whatever it is you're discussing. If the conversation should get heated or confrontational, and I, again, have participated in probably 20 and observed far more than that, I've never seen it happen, but if you were to be the first to have a confrontational and heated on the table conversation, maybe you say something like this. You know, perhaps we can revisit those conversation guidelines and we go back to saying that we've agreed we're going to respect everyone's opinions. If there's debate in the room, we can say something like this. You know, we don't have to find consensus today. We're simply here to learn and share. Or perhaps we should all take 30 seconds to regroup our thoughts on the question before moving forward. And if there's some discomfort in the room or low energy, maybe something like, let's take a pause for a moment, take a deep breath, and then we're going to move on. You know, those are just some ideas that could be effective. So, how can we ensure diversity at the table? I would say you cannot ensure diversity at the table because each table is going to be as diverse as each individual host's network. And I would say there's nothing wrong or particularly right with having a, you know, completely homogenous table. It's fine. If most people at the table end up having, you know, to be of the same socioeconomic status or the same religion or the same race, the same neighborhood, you know, that's okay. However, if we're seeking diverse tables, then we need to seek out diverse partners. And I know you all have done a fantastic job of doing that. You know, one simple way to do that is you invite four or five guests, and you ask each of your guests to bring somebody that you know, that they know, you won't know. I've seen that work well in business settings where businesses were hosting on the table, as well as in organizational on the tables, and just in terms of even conversations. individual homes. One of the most interesting conversations I participated in Lexington, it was a group of women from a local mosque, and they partnered with a group of Jewish women who came together for an on-the-table conversation. The food was delicious. And the conversation was incredible. You know, with that lightning round, you could also ask, what is one action everyone is personally willing to take within the next 6 months to create change, and just have people spitball their ideas really quickly? And then I think finally, how do you inspire action when closing out the conversation? I'll repeat myself to say, let the on-the-table experience kind of work its magic. Again, in 2018, 91% of the Bluegrass's participating survey respondents were on the table said they were likely to take a specific action to impact an issue discussed at their table. 69% said they learned about an important community issue that they really weren't aware of before their conversation. 57% said they left the table better understanding how to take action to address a community issue or challenge. 75%, 3 out of 4, said they met one or more new people, and more than 1/3 of the attendees actually exchanged contact information with someone they didn't know before. And perhaps most importantly, 96% said they wanted to come back to the table next year. So trust me, on the table inspires action itself. And then finally, one piece of advice I wish I had received before my first hosting gig was relax. After one conversation starter, I promise you, it does take on a life of its own. Mostly, people enjoy talking, and they enjoy eating, and they know how to do it in front of company. So you can kick back with that. And then I'll leave you with one last thought by Margaret Wheatley. There is no power for change greater than a community discovering what it cares about. I am really confident with the excellent leadership of the Central Carolina Community Foundation, you will absolutely find that to be true. So thank you so much, and we will open it up for questions that any of us can answer. Thank you for coming this evening.
What step number one is asking you to do is to submit your guest information to us. So this
aren't going to spam your desk, we aren't going to send them lots of emails. The reason why we want this information is so that we can send them the survey link and a reminder to take the survey afterwards, and also let them know when our community report comes out so they can be invited to know what the results are. If you have somebody who's uncomfortable with sharing their email address, that's okay. You don't have to share it with us, but what we do ask is there will be a blank for you to put how many participants and guests you had. Please at least let a minimum do that so that we have a count of how many people participated in these conversations. So that's your guest information. The next thing I want you to find is your those toolkit. So hold it up when you find it. Very good. Okay. This you can also find online if you happen to lose yours. But what this is a guide for how you can plan your conversation. So it will take you through everything from who do you invite to what do you talk about, what are the conversation prompts, to how do you get people to take the survey at the end of the night. So this is your guide to planning your conversation. Take some time to look through it, and I hope you'll have lots of useful information. The next thing I want you to find is your conversation prompts. If you can find those. So what these are, this is a handy sheet you can keep out on the table as you're asking and facilitating your conversation, and it has some sample questions that you can ask. Now, Lisa's going to talk a little bit more about how you can guide your conversations, but this is a reference guide, or if you want to pass it around your table so that people can maybe select a question that they might answer, that's another way that you can use this. Then two more items. The other one, you should have a stack of little notebooks in there. So these are intended to give to your guests. There's 12 of them, so if you need more, let us know, and we can give you more. But it has a variety of pages that your guests can take notes on and doodle on. We don't need to receive any of this information. It's private and for them. It's just for them to take notes while you're having a conversation. The one page I want to draw your attention to is the last page. And this page is specifically intended to help you think about what action you can take in your conversation. So it has a question on here about what are two actionable ideas that you want to act on after your conversation. So this is a really great tool that you can use to close and end your conversation. Have your guests flip to the end of this and have them write down two ideas that they're going to walk away with and act on afterwards. And then the final thing I want you to look at is these little tiny survey reminder cards. They're with your posters is where you'll find them. What these are also for your guests to take home, and it is a reminder for them to take the survey. It has a text code. What we really would suggest that you do with the survey is at the end of your conversation, allow 10-15 minutes at the end, ask all of your guests to take out their phone, give them this card, text that information, and have them take the survey before they even leave your conversation. That way you know it's been done. But if they don't want to do that, they'll have this card to take with them so that they remember. So, I've given you a lot of information. Oh, there are also additional resources. Let me find my clicker. Online, if you go to onthetable.org to our resources page, you'll find these additional toolkits. One is a youth conversation guide, so if you have any students or youth that are involved in your conversation, which we absolutely love and encourage, there's a lesson plan in there for schools. There's some questions that might be a little bit simpler for youth and kids versus some of our other ones. So definitely if you need involved, please utilize that toolkit. We also have a family discussion guide. So if you're a family and you want to have a conversation with multiple generations, we have a guide for that. And then finally, we have our toolkit has been translated into Spanish as well. So if you have any Spanish-speaking people participating in your conversation, or if you might be interested in hosting a table, please direct them to that resource. Our survey will also be translated into Spanish, so that's another option for you to consider. So, I've given you a lot of nitty-gritty details. There are three things I want you to remember from what I talked about, and this is where it gets a little more interactive. I see some deer headlight looks. What about that? So on the count of three, we're going to say info. One, two, three.
Info.
Okay. And the last thing I want you to remember is to have your guests to take the survey. So on the count of three, we're going to say survey. One, two, three.
Survey.
Okay. And we're going to put them all together. Try this. So on the count of three, say register, info, survey. Think you can do it? Okay. One, two, three.
Register, info, survey.
Great job! Thank you guys. We're glad everyone is joining back up to have our real treat for today. Community Foundation in 2009, she and I both joined Community Foundations when we had lost a lot of our assets. It was probably better to come in when you're low versus high and then see it go down. But since 2009, Lisa has led her organization to increasing their assets by over 400%. She had practiced law prior to joining the Community Foundation, and prior to joining the Community Foundation, she and her husband had also welcomed a daughter into their lives. So Lisa ran Community Foundations, which she still does, and is raising a wonderful daughter who's 17 years old and looking towards what college to go to next year. One of the things that Lexington and Columbia have in common is that we are both very community-focused, and we are both looking at how do we engage people in the community. So you've all heard of Midland Skids. Lexington, Kentucky also has a Good Giving Challenge that takes place the month of December. And since 2011, Bluegrass Community Foundation has raised over $8.4 million on behalf of 150 local nonprofits. The Community Foundation of Lexington is also very engaged in building community and making sure that the community that they are building is livable, that it's walkable, bikeable, it's welcoming. And underneath is Linda, that would be the other Community Foundation that's not here. Under Lisa's leadership, the Community Foundation has forged an extremely meaningful partnership with the government of Lexington, the city of Lexington. And in fact, they're on the table, oftentimes helps inform the city plans. Most importantly, Lisa has been a role model for me and a number of women in our field because she's compassionate, she's extremely bright, and she truly cares about the place that she calls home. I am so honored that she is willing to share her time and expertise with us so that we can have a successful on the table. Lisa, thank you.
Joanne, thank you so much. It is such a pleasure to be with all of you this evening to talk about On the Table, which it's a real joy because it's just a wonderful opportunity to come together, and I know that you're all going to love it. So, show of hands, how many of you love to talk? You enjoy talking? Okay, I'm worried about a few of you over on this side, but I'll give you another chance to redeem yourselves. How many of you love to eat? Okay, well, if you love to talk, to eat, you are fully qualified to host On the Table. So I can sit down and you can go home. But that is what we say, and I promise you it's true. If you love those two things, you really do have the fundamental skill set to host a successful On the Table conversation. Oh, that's me. So here's the thing. And this is not going to surprise anyone, I don't think, but humans were meant to be in relationship with one another. We just are. And we are meant to engage in relationships and have social interactions. In fact, one of the best determinants of social health, and in fact, our lifespan really is all about the strength of our social relationships and our social networks. So very great change starts from very small conversations held among people who care. I would credit for that, but it is actually a quote from Margaret Wheatley. Margaret Wheatley, she writes and she speaks extensively on the power of conversation. Actually, since 1966, Margaret has worked as an author, a speaker, a teacher, a community worker, a Peace Corps volunteer, a consultant, an advisor, and a formal leader. And from all of these experiences that Margaret has had, she has developed this unshakable conviction that we need leaders who put service over self and who display an unshakable faith that people can be generous, creative, and kind. And on the table is the perfect opportunity to engage with one another in a way that is generous, creative, and kind. So everybody has a story. And I mean, that's what's so great about coming around a table with people we know, as well as people who are meeting for the very first time. And that's the beauty of on the table. It can be people that you already know. You can also mix it up with people that you don't know and that you're meeting for the first time. There's really no wrong way to do on the table. And what you're going to find is that simple questions not only prompt important insights, they really can be critical to bridging differences. Everybody has a story, and by learning someone's story and sharing yours in return, it really is a great first step to building a new relationship. Prompts to get at what someone's story is could include something as simple as asking what's important to you. How do you want to be remembered? Tell me about your mom and dad. Or why are you in Columbia? How did you get here? In asking that kind of question in Lexington, at the same table, there was someone who said they're eighth generation in Lexington, Kentucky, and someone who moved there 6 months ago to take a job. So those are great sort of rapid icebreaker questions just to get things started. And of course, while everybody has a story, anybody can learn from yours. And the key here is a willingness to share. That's all you need. What you say doesn't need to be profound. It just has to be true. So while cave paintings may date back as far as 35,000 years ago, they now say, from our earliest times on Earth, humans dating back more than 250,000 years, we've had a hunger to communicate, whether that was, again, through paintings or through symbols or through verbal communication, but we've had this need for a very long time. And I will tell you that on the table is a simple, elegant strategy to respond to that hunger to communicate with one another. Now more than ever, and I was saying this a year ago and the year before that, but now I'm really saying it again, now more than ever, we have such a need for civil and civic discourse, and on the table is the perfect opportunity to do that, to engage it, to role model it. So, in North America, again, we have such a tradition, going back to indigenous peoples, of passing traditions from one generation to the next through an oral tradition. It's important to cultures across the globe, just as it is with Native Americans and other indigenous peoples. And who use storytelling, as we still do today, as a way to convey and preserve culture. Gathering together and telling our stories, it comes naturally to us, even though today many of us lack the opportunities to engage this way. But I promise you, it comes naturally to us. I wrote right all those cowboys around the campfire. So, okay, you may not be doing your on the table around the campfire, although maybe you have a fire pit in your backyard, and you will, and that is good too. But I think the thing about this do that too, but sharing a story, getting cozy and intimate. There's something about, you know, that number of 6 to 12 people and gathering around in a circle, although you can use a square table too if you want. But there is just something fundamentally powerful about storytelling and conversation. And really, if you have the courage to have courageous conversations, you can sometimes even change the world. And then, while there are formal, courageous conversations, there's also the informal. There is nothing like getting together with the familiar. You don't have to focus in your on-the-table conversation on solving world peace. I mean, you can take it on if you want to. But, you know, this photo, I think, so perfectly displays why we encourage folks to actually do their on-the-table over food and beverage. And you know, it doesn't have to be fancy. It can be breakfast, it can be lunch, it can be dinner, it can be tea time, it can be cookies and punch, it can be a brown bag. It can happen any conceivable way. It does not need to cost a lot of money. A potluck like this is a great way to do it. But good friends, good food, and good conversation are naturally reinforcing. And really, it's the small, everyday conversations that matter, too, as much as the ones that are boldly courageous. And both can be part of On the Table. You know, conversations can change the country, and conversations can be challenging. But there is a real place for consensus, for collaboration, and for compromise, particularly in our diverse, pluralistic society. We cannot move our communities forward unless we are brave enough to engage in meaningful civic conversations. So again, Margaret Wheatley, be brave enough to start a conversation that matters. I think it's excellent advice. And the point is, don't be afraid of the topics that might be surfaced at your table, because it will be a broad array of topics, and that's okay. It could be funny and familial one moment, and it could get serious and intense the next, and that's okay. On the table, there's room for all of it. So as you approach the conversation, I think there's just a few words that I'd ask you to think about. Intention. So how do we start a conversation that matters? And I'd suggest it's with a three-pronged approach and a three-pronged intention. One is the willingness to share. Two is the willingness to learn. And three, you combine that with an attitude of civility. And if we go in with that intention of being civil, it isn't going to matter what the topics are or how intense it gets if we really focus on that intention of civility. Next is voice, really the importance of voice. And what's so essential here is that everyone's voice matters. And especially the quietest voices and the voices that are not usually heard. So just keep that in mind, that every voice matters. And we'll even talk about a few strategies about how to elicit those quieter voices. So sharing is critical. Be willing to share your story and allow others the time to share theirs. I suggest you put aside preconceived notions of how the conversation ought to go and simply be open to the flow of conversation. What I can promise you is that no two on-the-table conversations will be alike, even if it was the same group of people discussing the same prompt, and certainly not if you're looking at hundreds of tables across the two honesty is the basis of a truly meaningful conversation, and truth is also critical for meaningful change. Listen. This is perhaps the most fundamental part of On the Table, is to listen, to be present, to allow others space, particularly if perhaps some of those others are not so often invited to the table. And that's the beauty of On the Table. Everyone's invited. Everyone's welcome. There is no qualification to join the table other than the interest to do so. For most of us in this room, I'll bet it's easy to talk and much more difficult to listen. I know it is for me. It's said that the greatest actors are determined not by the way they say their lines, but by the way they engage and react when listening. They actually say that probably no one's better than that than Claire Danes. So I don't know, maybe you want to go home and pull up something on demand and check her out when she's listening to other actors. And I guess maybe that's the key to getting both an Emmy, a Tony, and an Oscar. So practice active listening. Learn. To get at the core value offered by On the Table, we need to put aside the rampant tribalism of contemporary politics. That'll be fun, right? We can do that. If we're confident that we already know the answer to every question, then On the Table is an empty exercise. But if we approach On the Table open to the possibility that we have something to learn from everyone we meet and from everyone at the table, and that perhaps we can learn the most of all from those that are most different from ourselves, then On the Table will prove to be an invaluable tool to glean new insights and information to move our communities forward. Growth. With learning comes growth. And that saying in business that you're either growing or you're dying, it can equally apply to interpersonal relationships and communities. New opportunities like On the Table often present the most exciting opportunities for growth if we just stay open to the possibilities. Engage. Civic engagement is fundamental to a thriving democracy and a thriving community, which is just a mini democracy, right? On the Table is a simple, open-ended, and welcoming, friendly way to engage with a diverse array of citizens. So really, take the opportunity, and it can be really exciting for everyone that participates. Act. By acting with intention and actively engaging with others to discuss our hopes for our community, the greatest needs of our community, and what we can do together to create positive change, an agenda for action will reveal itself through your on-the-table conversations. I promise. There's nothing extraordinary you'll need to do, but just other than have the conversation itself. Results, we're all very results-oriented folks. And what I can tell you as a product of 2 years of on-the-table conversations in Lexington, Kentucky, and surrounding counties, is that we've learned that the power of conversation to clarify, energize, and organize people to do things for good is real. It really happens. When we come together, as Joanne said, to listen and learn from each other, it can have an incredibly powerful impact. In 2017, which was our first On the Table, our unified city-county government was updating its comprehensive plan, which is required to do statutorily every where you show up at a community center or a library and give your input. But as a result of On the Table, they had thousands of people that came to the table to talk about what's great, what could be better, and what we could do to change our community. And one of the most contentious issues in Lexington, Kentucky, is our urban service boundary. We have this 50-mile radius urban service boundary, really, I believe, the first one in the country to actually protect that beautiful rolling bluegrass geography. And as you might imagine, it creates a lot of tension with development interests. And at the same time, there are people who point out that both our agricultural industry and our thoroughbred equine industry is a really important part of all of that. In any event, what I will tell you, in our most recently updated comprehensive plan, that urban service boundary held. And On the Table and the conversations and the overwhelming support that was articulated for holding that urban service boundary, On the Table's been credited time and time again for giving the people the opportunity to speak and to impact that process. But on the other hand, results from On the Table were as simple as a new community garden being created, or a particular neighborhood association now jointly deciding they were going to actually use those recycling bins that had been distributed because one number was made crazy, one neighbor was made crazy that on recycling day, it was only her blue bin, and everybody else's blue bins were not pulled to the curb. And she came up with this really fun neighborhood competition and game where everyone could win prizes by, you know, rallying around and getting their blue bins out. That was a result of On the Table, too. In 2018, our second On the Table, 91% of participants reported that they were going to take a specific action based on something they learned or discussed during their On the Table conversation. There was no magic to that. As I said, the conversations really will lead to the creation of your own action agenda. So I understand there have been a lot of questions about how you do this, and we're moving right into that now. So a question was asked, how do you set expectations for the agenda and begin the conversation? And I think Therese had a wonderful display of exactly what you do. My additional suggestions would be set expectations by being clear in your invitation to your guests. Help them understand what they're being invited to. Explain that you're hosting an informal conversation about not only what makes our community great, but what can make it better. Let them know the time limit, so if your function's going to be 60 minutes or 90 minutes, I'd be really clear about that up front. And remember, you're supposed to reserve 15 minutes to do your survey right there. And then the only agenda I would suggest is that there is no agenda. Keep it informal. Again, if you like to eat and you like to talk, you can do this. And, you know, if you have concerns, you know who you're inviting. And by that I mean, you know who you know, and you know who's going to be a surprise. So you know what the combination of your guests perhaps is going to look like. You know, you might start by reviewing those three quick rules that were laid out in the host instruction card under the don'ts. They're also, by the way, on page 6 of your host toolkit. And you might do something like this right as you're going to start your conversation. When everyone's gone around and said their name and introduced themselves, you might just say, can we all agree on three things as we launch into our conversation? One, we agree not to be judgmental or dismissive of the comments of others. Two, we agree we're not here to argue or promote unproductive debate. And three, we agree to make no campaign speeches or promote particular political agendas. You do not have to memorize that. That is right on page 6 of your toolkit. Now, for some of you, that may not be necessary, but begin the conversation. Again, those are the great prompts. I found one of your prompts on page 7 of your host toolkit or on your reminder card that you set on the table. What would you say if you were bragging about Columbia? I would tell you my first on the table conversation, I probably participated in more than 20 over 2 years. CEOs get around during on the table day. But once we asked, what would you say if you're bragging about Lexington? One thing, we kind of did as a quick opening round, and the conversation just took off. We never really had the occasion to refer back to any of those other conversation starters because the conversation was simply organic from there, and I think you'll find that true as well. So, what topics do we talk about? Use your host toolkit. You do not have to worry about this. There are wonderful prompts on the sheet in your toolkit on page 7, and you cannot go wrong if you use any one of those starters. My suspicion is whichever one you pick, you'll very likely never get to a second or a third because the conversation will become organic from that point. And I will say I did observe one on the table back in Lexington. I'm not going to tell you it's wrong, but because apparently that group liked it, but it was a super host, so there were a lot of tables going on in a single location, and they actually decided to have a moderator up at the front, just like me. All the tables were out there, and they decided to go through all the prompts in an hour and 15 minutes. And I popped in there, and I will, this is just one woman's view, but a prompt would start, and then you would just hear the conversation. You know, the room would get loud, people are discussing, and then it would go, time's up. And they have to move on to the next one. And I'm going to tell you that it's not how I would suggest doing your on-the-table conversation, unless you want to have like a 7-hour on-the-table conversation, and then have that, do them all. But I really believe part of the impact and the effectiveness is keeping it informal and organic. So what is off the table? What's, again, interesting to me from the Chicago Community Trust, the community foundation there in Chicago that innovated it, the whole name on the table came from their discussion about if we're going to have a community conversation, what should the topic be? And as they talked about narrowing it down to one topic, someone said, everything should be on the table. Nothing should be off the table. And that is how he came up with the name On the Table. So I suggest that everything's on the table and there's nothing that you need to, ban from your conversation. You know, I don't know if in your communities, opioid epidemic, or race relations, or homelessness, or housing affordability, or policing, or the treatment and status of immigrants, or inequities in code enforcement are ever issues, but they are in Lexington and the counties that we serve at Bluegrass Community Foundation. And I will tell you that all of these topics surface at On the Table, along with hundreds and hundreds of others. I think maybe like 800 different topics in all surfaced. And you know, a few of those that I mentioned that certainly probably have some controversy and strong opinions, a few of those rose to the top as the most frequently discussed issues. And what I'll tell you about that is that everybody lived and nobody was shocked. Those issues came up. So I would encourage you not to take a particular topic and move it off the table. So, how do you manage personalities? And I probably should say, how do you manage difficult personalities and make sure everyone's voices are heard? Again, I might start by getting agreement on those, you know, three agreements before we launch. And then, it probably depends. If a conversation is being dominated by one or more individuals, you might say something like this. Jack, that is great, but you know, let's hear from two more people and then we're going to move on to the next topic. We want to hear from those who have not yet had a chance to share their ideas. Or you could say, you know, Debbie, we haven't heard from you, but I'd love to know your opinion on whatever it is you're discussing. If the conversation should get heated or confrontational, and I, again, have participated in probably 20 and observed far more than that, I've never seen it happen, but if it were, if you were to be the first to have a confrontational and heated on the table conversation, maybe you'd say something like this. You know, perhaps we can revisit those conversation guidelines and we go back to saying that we've agreed we're going to respect everyone's opinions. If there's debate in the room, we can say something like this. You know, we don't have to find consensus today. We're simply here to learn and share. Or perhaps we should all take 30 seconds to regroup our thoughts on the question before moving forward. And if there's some discomfort in the room or low energy, maybe something like, let's take a pause for a moment, take a deep breath, and then we're going to move on. You know, those are just some ideas that could be effective. So how can we ensure diversity at the table? I would say you cannot ensure diversity at the table because each table is going to be as diverse as each individual host network. And I would say there's nothing wrong or particularly right with having a, you know, completely a homogenous table. It's fine. If most people at the table end up having, to be of the same socioeconomic status or the same religion or the same race, the same neighborhood, you know, that's okay. However, if we're seeking diverse tables, then we need to seek out diverse partners. And I know you all have done a fantastic job of doing that. One simple way to do that is you invite four or five guests, and you ask each of your guests to bring somebody that you know, that they know, you won't know. I've seen that work well in business settings where businesses were hosting on the table, as well as in organizational on the tables, and just in terms of even conversations held in individual homes. One of the most interesting conversations I participated in Lexington, it was a group of women from a local mosque, and they partnered with a group of Jewish women who came together for an on-the-table conversation. The food was delicious. And the conversation was incredible. Without lightning round, you could also ask, what is one action everyone is personally willing to take within the next 6 months to create change? And just have people spitball their ideas really quickly. And then think finally, how do you inspire action when closing out the conversation? I'll repeat myself to say, let the on-the-table experience kind of work its magic. Again, in 2018, 91% of the Bluegrasses participating survey respondents from on the table said they were likely to take a specific action to impact an issue discussed at their table. 69% said they learned about an important community issue that they really weren't aware of before their conversation. 57% said they left the table better understanding how to take action to address a community issue or challenge. 75%, 3 out of 4, said they met one or more new people. And more than one-third of the attendees actually exchanged contact information with someone they didn't know before. And perhaps most importantly, 96% said they wanted to come back to the table next year. So trust me, on the table inspires action itself. And then finally, one piece of advice I wish I had received before my first hosting gig was relax. After one conversation starter, I promise you, it does take on a life of its own. Mostly, people enjoy talking, and they enjoy eating, and they know how to do it in front of company. So you can kick back, you with one last thought by Margaret Wheatley. There is no power for change greater than a community discovering what it cares about. I am really confident with the excellent leadership of the Central Carolina Community Foundation, you will absolutely find that to be true. So thank you so much, and we will open it up for questions that any of us can answer. Thank you for coming.